Intimate partner violence is an incontestably sensitive issue that is especially near and dear to my very own heart. If you or anyone that you know is suspected of experiencing any level of abuse, or you yourself are experiencing any form of emotional, psychological, spiritual, or physical abuse, please do contact the following number sooner than later. You may also text or chat with a live advocate anonymously. All pertinent information shall be enlisted via the description box below. Spirit bears the strength and capacity to unequivocally evolve for the better, and in seamless alignment with this simple yet profound truth, it is of my firm belief that heartfelt hope, soul deep redemption, and comprehensive healing are curative avenues for which direct victims, vicarious victims, and perpetrators may volitionally commune with. Yet it is ultimately up to the individual to traverse through the gateway of transfiguration. Prior to officially moving forth with our regularly scheduled program, let's commune with a brief yet thoroughly concise explication on intimate partner violence, specifically in relation to Black femicide.
Intimate partner violence is not limited to any race, country, gender, or sexual orientation. It has been a long-running feature of patriarchal society in numerous civilizations and cultures, not just during the 244 years of official American existence. At least 4 million American women a year, of all races, are abused by their partners, and this includes homosexual relationships. In America, approximately 3 women are killed by a spouse, lover, or partner every day. In recent years, 53% of these women are Black. In fact, Black women are 4 times more likely than their white peers to be murdered by a lover and 7 times more likely to be killed when pregnant than white women. To make matters worse, 9 out of 10 murdered Black women were killed by a man they knew. When we broaden the scope of intimate partner violence to include reported rapes and physical abuse by a woman's partner, at least 40% of Black women have had these experiences, making them the group most likely to be abused by a partner. In recent times, the leading cause of death among Black girls aged 1 through 19 after unintentional injuries is homicide, with 15.5% of deaths being a murder. For Black women ages 20 through 44, homicide is the 4th leading cause, comprising 7% of deaths. To put domestic homicide of Black women further into perspective, think of it like this. Police killed 1,165 people in 2018. 26.7%, or 215, of those people were Black. Now, in 2016, 517 Black women were murdered by a man, with 91%, or 470, murdered by someone they knew. Of those women, 272 were murdered by a husband, boyfriend, or ex.
Now back to our regularly scheduled programming. Salutations. Serene Eminence here. It's a pleasure to conclude part 1 of the Judgeship Executions series, which focuses on varying degrees of veritable and alleged cases of exorcide. We shall be taking a brief intermission from judgeship prior to officially delving into part 2, dedicating our efforts towards disentangling a case of exorcide coupled by filicide, which were sickening crimes committed by Alex Murdoch, of whom is a fixture of a prominent prosecutorial family. The preceding judgeship executions episodes were centered upon 2 hard-hearted cases for which judges played their part in the demise of their once beloved spouses, wherein Superior Court Judge Jeffrey Malcolm Ferguson drunkenly shot his wife to death, confessed to the courts, then pleaded not guilty, claiming that the incident was an accident. A pretrial hearing has been set for October the 30th. As such, follow-up content shall be offered as Halloween approaches. Respective to case coverage of episode number 2, appellate court judge Jacques Delisle admitted to assisted spousal suicide and was later acquitted in respects to a miscarriage of justice after serving a mere 9 years of his 25-year-to-life sentence. Today we shall be covering the case of Common Pleas Judge Lance Timothy Mason, of whom heartlessly stabbed his wife to death in front of his daughters, then hastily stole his slain ex-wife's SUV and proceeded to recklessly ram the automobile into a police vehicle whilst attempting to evade capture. Although the Vocational Volatility Channel has covered an unfathomable amount of fatalities, 19 to be exact, this vicious act of violence was particularly egregious. The sheer lack of regard emanating from the depravedly devoid soul that committed this crime is undeniably detestable. The proximity to the palpable anguish as she was repeatedly stabbed whilst pleading for her life is exceedingly abhorrent. And for this lethal instance of intimate partner violence to have occurred in the vicinity of the couple's children is truly a painfully heartbreaking reality. This savage scene shall be seared into the hearts and minds of these juvenile souls for an eternity, and the multidimensional transference of trauma shall inevitably impact them in manners unseen, yet nuancedly enduring. Only time shall tell how they manage to individually develop, heal, and cope in light of witnessing such darkness. Eminence Insights. Men who engage in aggressive acts of violence towards their spouses suffer from an insufferable sense of powerlessness. The spousal slayings that we have witnessed thus far are visceral depictions of the perpetrator's projected spiritual turmoil harbored internally, haphazardly enacted externally via the not-so-protected space of their intimate partnership dynamics. Educational insights. In offering validified qualitative context, whilst working on my Master's of Science degree, I conducted research in accordance with a biological anthropologist, examining the correlates of esteem stability and aggression type, whilst utilizing self-control as a moderator. Aggression is expressed on a spectrum and is moderated by multitudinous factors, but in a manner most aligned with publicized psychological and anthropological literature in relation to the aforementioned scope of study. The results suggested that individuals with unstable esteem and or low self-esteem are more likely to lose self-control and adopt negative coping styles such as aggressive behavior when faced with external stressors. These hostile responses are typically defensively postured as power moves, yet truly are enacted as a means by which to covertly override deep-seated feelings of perceived inadequacy, inferiority, and shame, making it such that low self-esteemed individuals are increasingly more prone to reactive aggression. Respectively, those with high levels of stabilized narcissism tend to operate differentially, honing their aggression and fueling its tumultuously clandestine essence into planned acts of deliberate hostility, making it such that aggression is expressed on a spectrum in relation to levels of self-esteem, with self-control acting as a significant correlative moderator. Eminence Insights. We must aspire for higher means of viscerally understanding our inner workings so that we might constructively manage our spiritual operating systems. There is something exquisitely elegant about a lady of whom bears the capability of eviscerating the entirety of someone's natural existence, yet intensely chooses not to, as she knows that contending with the overarching principality shall inevitably increase the likelihood of annihilating the entire stream of consciousness that has noxiously extended its reach unto the entities that knowingly or unknowingly uphold the principality in question. As we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Eminence, insights. In respect to the purported motive of paranoid paternal protection, he didn't want to put his daughters in that precarious situation of possibly being sexually abused without his knowledge. And since he didn't have full custody of the children due to his domestic abuse, he thought it best to execute the individual seemingly standing in his way of comprehensively safeguarding the safety of his children. Yet, in doing so, he literally left them abandoned with no parental presence nor protection, and thus he unequivocally failed at his overarching mission. Although an admirable aspiration on the very surface, his explanation is not a sensibly justified reason to have moved forth with his barbaric actions as he did. It can wholeheartedly be argued that his senseless actions ushered his beloved daughters forth into a more emotionally, mentally, and spiritually precarious situation than he could even come to comprehensively fathom. These excuses that I have heard from these judges are nonsensical, unacceptable, unequivocally detestable, and I abhor it, but I will reveal it, and we will commune with the truth at all costs, and I appreciate you all wholeheartedly for communing with me, for traversing with me through these deep, dark, dimensional spaces. And I look forward to exposing more, to shedding light and awareness upon the shadows. And so I thank you kindly for tuning in with me, beautifully beloved beings. And until next time, you all, please stay safe. Definitely stay stealthy. And evermore stay serene.
And weak is not good. The people who shoot up the high schools, they're weak. They're weak.
How is it good to be dangerous?
Because it makes you formidable. And life is a very difficult process. And it's not for, you're not prepared for it unless you have the capacity for to be dangerous. Those who have swords and know how to use them but keep them sheathed will inherit the world. That's a way better way of thinking about it. You have to be powerful and formidable and then peaceful, in that order, right? And that's not the same as being naive and weak and harmless, which is what young men are being encouraged to be. It's like, that's a very bad idea. It's a very bad idea. Because naive, weak, and harmless means that you can't withstand the tragedies of life. You can't bear any responsibility. You'll end up bitter. And when you get bitter, then you get dangerous.
But one thing I'm not getting, there's a big difference between letting people do something for themselves and saying men should be dangerous. By dangerous, that implies I should be ready to threaten someone, to hurt somebody.
No, you should be capable of it. But that doesn't mean you should use it. There's nothing to you otherwise. Like, if you're not a formidable force, there's no morality in your self-control. If you're incapable of violence, not being violent isn't a virtue. People who teach martial arts know this full well, right? If you learn a martial art, you learn to be dangerous, but simultaneously you learn to control it. Both of those come together. And the combination of that capacity for danger and the capacity for control is what brings about the virtue. Otherwise, you confuse weakness with moral virtue. I'm harmless, therefore I'm good. It's like, no, that isn't how it works. That isn't how it works at all. If you're harmless, you're just weak. And if you're weak, you're not going to be good. You can't be, because it takes strength to be good. It's very difficult to be good.